Alright, good evening. Here we are for yet another lovely lecture of MENG 3310, Fluid Mechanics. So this lecture is going to be divided into three pieces. It's going to be quite a late night, as you might be able to estimate looking at the clock here, so that's okay. Alright, so the first portion of this lecture is going to go over sections 2.1, 2.3, and 2.5 in the textbook. We have two objectives for this first portion of the lecture. The first is going to be apply Newton's second law to a static fluid element in order to obtain the hydrostatic pressure equation. And the second is going to be to apply the hydrostatic pressure equation to determine pressure at various points in a fluid at various depths in a container with several fluids, if necessary. So let us derive the hydrostatic equation for pressure. So let's do that. Let us look at the hydrostatic equation for pressure. Hydrostatic equation for pressure. Hydrostatic equation for pressure. Here. Now let's take a look at this. Okay, again, as we learned last time, or in the first lecture, that the study of forces applied by fluids at rest is known as fluid statics. So this is an application of fluid statics. So I'm going to take a, I'm going to look at a tiny differential element. And let's take a look at this. So I'm going to have a tiny differential element here. And so this is going to be small relative to the container. Or in other words, we can assume that the effective size of it is zero. It has a it's a differential element, so just like you've seen in calculus class. Here, so consider a small differential element here. So we're going to have a fluid prism. However, I'm going to slice this at angle theta. At angle theta. And it's static. Therefore, this means that there'll be no shear on any plane. No shear on any plane. It being static means that there is no shear on any plane, as we saw in the first lesson. Okay, so let us analyze this. Let us look at what happens when we do this. So, consider this same pressure prism, but blown up such that we can analyze the forces and pressures therein. So pressure at a point. I'm going to draw this as a prism, but in reality it's going to be so small it can be considered a point. At a point. Pressure at a point. So I'm going to draw this. I'm going to try to draw this properly in three dimensions, although we'll see how well this works. So let's look at this here. I'm going to have x, y, and z axis here. The x, the y, and the z here. Then labeling this, I'm going to have, so I'm going to draw my prism like this here. It's going to be kind of triangular. It's cut at, basically it's the rectangle above, the rectangular prism above, cut at a certain angle, and that angle is going to be theta. And basically, as we work through this derivation, the theta will cancel out. And then I can show what's behind, hidden behind here in dashed lines. And this coming down here. All right, so let's do that. Now, let's label some dimensions. I am going to label this delta z. Delta x, our angle of cut here is theta. This is delta y. And I'm going to call the length of the hypotenuse simply L. Simply L here. Now let us look at this from a elevation view. So I'm going to look at this directly along the xz plane. So I'm going to look at this directly along the xz plane. X and z. So here I have this plane here. And here is my prism. Now, I'm going to again label my dimensions. Well, actually, let me show you the axis, the third axis. Y is actually going to be coming out of the page here, but you're not going to be able to see it's coming directly out of the page. This is R delta Z, R delta X, and R theta. Now let us look at the pressures on here. And the pressures on here, I'm just going to simply label them, well, I don't know what they are yet. I'm just going to label them P1, P2, and P3. So I'm going to stick with it in just very general terms, and then see where the math leads us. P1 along the horizontal, or I should you could well it's acting horizontally, but it's along the vertical face. So depending whether you want to call it horizontal or vertical, I suppose is up to you. Then I'm going to have a P2 here. P2, constant value along here, constant value along here, and a P3. And a P3 here. Now, I do need to work through the trig a little bit, so let me show you this. If I do have an element of P3, this is going to be a review from your trigonometry and physics classes through the years. The vertical component of this is going to be P3 cosine theta, and the horizontal component is going to be P3 sine theta. P3 sine theta. Now, let's see. I will tell you to notice a few things with this that I'll be using in the later derivation. Notice, or on the following slide, this will be important. Here, sine of theta is equal to delta z over L, and cosine of theta is equal to, so that's theta there. Cosine theta is equal to delta x divided by L here. Next, I'm going to apply Newton's second law, which again is simply sum of forces equals mass times acceleration along an axis, or in this case, of course, it's a statics problem, the acceleration is zero. So the sum of forces is simply going to equal zero. Now I have pressures here. I need to transform them into forces by multiplying by areas. So using Newton's second law here, use Newton's second law. Use Newton's second law. Use Newton's second law. I'm going to first do a summation of forces in the x direction. Summation of forces in the x direction is P1 times delta z delta y minus p3, p3 times sine theta, that is the x component of p3, times an area of L times delta y. And this equals zero. However, I can in turn realize something and that, or realize and or recognize something, that this sine theta L is simply equal to delta z. So then something miraculous happens, or something really cool happens. I'll have delta z delta y, delta z delta y, and so these two are going to cancel out. And I am going to be left with simply P1 is equal to P3. Then if I do a summation of forces in the y direction, I'm going to end up with P2 times delta x delta y minus P3 times the cosine of theta, that is the vertical component of P3, cosine theta times L delta y equals 0. And I can do the same kind of thing here, the same process, and recognize here that this cosine theta L is simply delta x here. And then if I have delta x delta y on the left, I also have delta x delta y on the right. So those two cancel out, well, including that delta y. So I am left then with simply P2 is equal to P3. Or I can come in and say, hey, look, P2, P3, these are all the same. P1, the overall relationship here is P1 equals P2 equals P3, or simply P. That is my ultimate relationship here. P1 is equal to P2 is equal to P3, or simply equal to P. And this is what's known as Pascal's law. Pascal's law states, well, let's see, let's write this out. Pascal's law says that if you have a point in a fluid of constant, let me just kind of draw this here. So I'm going to have a fluid or a container filled with the fluid and I'm going to look at a certain point in that fluid here. So looking at a certain point, and it's going to have the same pressure in all directions. So something like, doesn't matter what direction, the same P will be applied. P, 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 and P. So again, Pascal's law simply states that pressure is the same. Pressure is independent of direction. Is independent of direction. Of direction. As long as no shear forces are present, or no shear stresses are present. As long as no shear stresses are present. In other words, we have a pressure of equal intensity in all directions. Equal intensity in all directions. So next, let me first check, make sure the recording is running fine, and it is, so we're good. And once I once recorded a 2-hour lecture and then found the camera wasn't rolling, so that always has me really paranoid when I'm recording these videos. So now let's look at the pressure variation in a fluid at rest. So in the previous example, I was looking at a single point. So in other words, I was looking at a differential element or a single point such that the actual dimensions of this element could be assumed to be zero. Now, what if I look at a larger volume? I look at a larger volume so that its dimensions are not assumed to be zero. So let's look at pressure variation in a fluid at rest. So now I'm going to consider the case of a fluid that is not, that its volume is not insignificant, or its dimensions are not insignificant at rest here. Pressure variation in a fluid at rest. So I'm going to have, this time I'm going to draw a cubic element, a cubic prism. Y, X, and Z. And I'm going to draw it like so. So I have this here, and here, here, and here. And then like this, this, maybe more like that, that, that. Why don't you love my lovely art skills? And like this. And then here, here, and here. Now let's look at the forces on here. Actually, first let me label the dimensions. This is going to be delta x. So I'm going to let this dimension here be delta x. This dimension here be delta z. And I'm kind of putting it a bit a ways away from the prism, just for give myself some room to label some other things. And then this is going to be delta y along the y-axis. So this has dimensions delta x, delta y, and delta z. Then let me show you the forces acting on here. Well, I'm going to have the weight of the fluid, the weight vector. Then, so that's going to be I have a weight vector, I have the weight of the fluid, and that is going to be acting about the center of mass of the fluid. And then on this box, I have four pressures. I'm going to call this one P4, this one P3. So that's acting in the x direction on these spaces here, on the left and right face. Then on the front and back face, I'm going to have pressure 1, P1, along the y-axis, acting along the rear face. And then I'm going to have P2 acting again along the y-axis, but on the front face. Then in the z-direction, I'm going to have P5 pushing down on the top, and P6 pushing up on the bottom. P6. So I'm then going to do a force equilibrium, transforming these into these pressures into forces. So let's do this. So a force equilibrium, again for a static case. Force equilibrium for a static case. Okay, so let's see this. And again, I'm going to need to multiply by the surface, just like I did in the previous one. I'm to transform these pressures into forces. I'm going to need to multiply by areas. So the sum of forces in the x direction is going to be equal to P4 times delta y delta z minus P3 times delta y delta z is equal to 0. However, these are going to clearly, the delta y delta z's are going to clearly cancel out, so that goes away. And I am then left with simply P3 is equal to P4. Or I can conclude that the delta p over delta x is equal to 0. There is no, the rate of change in the x direction is 0 for pressure. And I'm going to do this, the x and the y on this slide and the z on the next slide. So the sum of forces in the y direction is going to be equal to P2 times delta x delta z minus P2, or minus P1, sorry, times delta x delta z delta z equals 0. Then I can cancel out the dimensions, so that goes away and that goes away, and so I'm simply left again with P2, or not again, I should just simply say similarly, I get that P2 is equal to P1. In other words, I can see that delta p over delta y, it should say y, not x, is also equal to zero. So, in other words, the pressure does not vary in x or y. Now, let's do a summation of forces in the z direction. Summation of forces in the z direction. This is going to give us p6 times delta x delta y minus p5 times delta x delta y. However, then I will get minus w is the third one. So I'm getting a little ahead of myself. However, I can recognize here that w is equal to something. W is the weight of the fluid, and that's simply going to be equal to, well, W is just equal to rho g times the volume v. Rho, the density, the mass density, times g times the volume. So then, I will have p6 times, again, well, let me just actually not get rid of the parentheses. P6 times delta x delta y minus P5 times delta x delta y minus rho g times delta x delta y delta z. I have replaced the volume with delta x delta y delta z. Now a few things will cancel out. The delta x's will cancel out. The delta y's will cancel out, but I will be left with a delta z. So what I will find is that p6 minus p5 is equal to rho g delta z, or simply delta p is equal, so delta p is equal to rho g delta z. In other words, the pressure change with respect to height is, or with respect to depth, is not zero. So delta P, delta Z, is not equal to zero. So that's sort of a takeaway here. That's a key element here. And this is a key element to take away, and this is a key element to take away. So let us look at a reference plane. Let's consider a reference plane. In terms of, this is discussing absolute versus gauge pressure. So say I have a reference plane here. Reference plane. All right, so let us say I have a little element here, my cube here, and I have a surface here, and let's say I'm defining z from the surface. I didn't actually, in the previous case, I was just considering an arbitrary element of fluid, but what happens if I specifically define z as at the surface? So z here is right at the surface. And what I will find is, here, well, if I plot this first of all, I will get a linear relationship between pressure and depth, P and Z, starting at zero. And this will have a positive slope, and that slope will just be dz and dp. Then, so again, this is positive slope, let me note that. Here, based on this reference frame, Here, I can say that delta P over delta Z is equal to gamma. Our weight density, our gamma, is going to be our the slope of the pressure versus Z line. And again, note, just do note something. Note, gamma does not need to be constant. You can have different, it's just something to be aware of. You can have different gammas. It doesn't need to be constant. If you have a fluid with different layers, you can have different gammas. What really matters is that the gamma is constant across a given elevation. So let's get the full hydrostatic pressure distribution equation next. Hydrostatic pressure distribution equation. Hydrostatic pressure distribution equation. So, say we have this here. So, say we have a system again defining z from the surface, from a free surface. And I'm going to do this in terms of gauge pressure. So, here's my surface. And say I have two points, one and two, at different depths. One and two at different depths. And z again is measured from the surface. I have z measured from the surface, and this is z1, and this is z2. All right, and we know that P delta z is gamma. Delta P delta z is gamma. If I separate the variables and then integrate, I can say that the integral from P1 to P2, in other words, if I separate the variables and then add an integral sign, I'll get something like this. P1 to P2 is equal to the integral z1 to z2 gamma dz. Or if I accept that the gamma is constant from z1 to z2, I can say that gamma, or sorry, integral. Let's see here. That's good. P1 to P2 dp equals gamma integral of from z1 to z2 of dz, or then p2 minus p1 equals gamma times z2 minus z1, or simply p2 is equal to p1 plus gamma times z2 minus z1. Z2 minus z1. So again, this is hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure with constant gamma from 1 to 2. With constant gamma from 1 to 2. Note, we do have a few notes, things to note, the takeaways. Again, let's see here. Note, pressure is the same. Is same at any x comma y for a z, a given z. So at any depth, it doesn't matter what x and y coordinate you're at, it's going to be the same pressure. And pressure varies linearly if gamma is constant, with depth, of course. varies linearly if gamma constant. So let's look at how that works. Consider two systems. Let's say I have two different tanks of water here, or really any fluid would do. So one is kind of a weird L-shaped container, and one is just maybe a fish tank or something, just a simple rectangular prism container. Here. So each of these are going to be the same height. So let's say both of these have the same height, and they both have a free surface at the top. They both have a free surface here and a free surface here. And they are filled with some sort of fluid. It could be water, it could be anything you like. Okay, so again, these are the same height, both height h. Z is measured from the surface going down. And this is height z, and we'll just accept that both of them are height z, have a depth of, sorry, not z, h. Both of them have a height h, or a depth h. Now, if I look at a certain, let's actually just go ahead and say they're water. So they each have a gamma of water. Gamma water. Now, let's look at different points. So, if I look at this point here and this point here, saying that they're at the same height, well, they're going to have the same pressure. These two points, even though at this point the vessel is much wider over here than this one, it doesn't matter. They're going to have the same pressure. Or, if I look at a series of points along the bottom here, each of them would have the exact same pressure. All of these points along the bottom here all same pressure. Each and every one of them would have the same pressure. And then note, now it's, at first glance this seems intuitive, however it's actually not intuitive because it's not necessarily intuitive, because while the pressure is constant at the bottom, the overall force, if I literally put this on a scale, I would find that this one weighed more than this one. There's still more material here, but the pressure is going to be, this pressure is going to be the same, but the overall weight is going to be larger on this one than this one, simply due to the, because the areas are not the same. The overall volumes are not the same. But anyway, I can say, again, if I were to look at this, I would say that, this is 1 and this is 2. Well, actually no, let's have this one be 1 and this one be 2 down here. Well, P2 is going to be equal to P1 plus gamma H, or if I look at this in terms of absolute pressure, P2 would be P1, actually P atmosphere, doesn't look like a very good H, P atmosphere, the atmospheric pressure, plus gamma H, and if I was looking at gauge pressure, well, P2 would simply be equal to gamma H. This would be 0. The P1 would be 0. Okay. Finally, I'd like to work through a few examples for this portion of the video. So, say I have... let me work through three examples, if I have some time. Example 1. Example 1. I'm given... what's known as a sand pipe. This is a tall pipe full of sand, and then but it's as such that a fluid can pass through. It's used for the purposes of water purification. So given I have a sand pipe, don't need to worry about the sand. It's not going to affect things. We're only concerned about the fluid. as far as are concerned, it's just filled with water. A sand pipe, 80 feet above ground, filled with water. Filled with water. Filled with water. Find a pressure. You know what? Should probably say standpipe, not sandpipe. I think I got little errors in my notes. Standpipe. That makes a bit more sense than a tall pipe filled with sand. Let's say standpipe. That makes me feel better. Derp. Pressure at a hydrant connected to standpipe. I believe I may have written these down wrong. Connected to standpipe. That makes a little bit more sense. I was worrying about the sand in there and how that would screw things up, but let's not worry about that. Let's just make it a standpipe, and that will make things a lot more friendly. So I guess you could have a pipe full of sand for water purification purposes, but we're going to call it a standpipe, and then we don't have to worry about any kind of sand. So anyway, say basically we have a situation like this. We have a point one. Well, I'm going to have a system that's full of a fluid. I'm going to be interested in the pressure here. Here is the surface. And this is gamma water, which is 62.4 pounds per cubic foot. And this thing is 80 feet high. This thing is 80 feet high. 80 feet high, and as always, z is going to be measured from the top down. And then the two points are going to be one up here at the surface and two down at the base. So, since gamma is constant between one and two, between 1 and 2. I'm going to say that P2, P2 is equal to P1 plus gamma times Z2 minus C1. However, P1 is 0 because we're working with gauge pressure. So therefore, P2 then is equal to 0 plus 62.4 PCF. This is 80 and 0, 80 feet minus 0 feet. So this is 4992 pounds per square foot. Or I can say, or in PSI, P2 is equal to 34.7 PSI. Just divide by 144 or 12 squared. 34.7 pounds per square inch. Example two. So given, say I hike up a 150 foot tall hill, what is the change in pressure? So given elevation change of 150 feet, and this is air. Find the change in pressure. Change in pressure. Find the change in pressure. So, from a table in the book, I will find, from the references in the book, I can find that the gamma of air, approximately near sea level, is 7.65 Times 10 to the negative 2 pounds per cubic foot. So then, delta P is simply going to be 7.65 times 10 to the negative 2 pounds per cubic foot times 150 feet, I'm just multiplying gamma times h, which will be 11.5 pounds per cubic, or pounds per square foot, or 0.797 pounds per square inch. And either of those would be a reportable solution. Oh, orange. Okay. Finally, I have an example 3 I want to work through. And this is showing how to work with a fluid of non-constant gamma. So, example 3. I am told that a fluid behaves according to this equation. Given, I have a fluid that the density actually increases with depth. I am told that gamma equals kz plus gamma naught. So gamma naught is its pressure at basically, is its density at basically zero pressure, and k is a constant. So this is its pressure when it's not under any pressure. This is, its density when it's not under any pressure. And k is a constant. That shows how much it increases by with depth. So where k is constant, and gamma zero is the specific weight. Actually, I'm being a little bit lazy with my terminology. Sometimes I refer to this as density if I'm feeling really lazy, but really the correct term, of course, is specific weight. Sorry. Weight density, or specific weight at free surface. At free surface. Rho is density, gamma is specific weight, as we saw in the previous lecture. And so find P as a function of Z. Pressure as a function of Z. Pressure variation with depth. Pressure variation with depth. With depth. Bit of a tongue twister. So, in other words, I'm going to have a certain system here of a surface here, a free surface. This is where our solution starts. Solution. And so at the surface, our pressure is zero. P0 equals zero. And we have a certain gamma naught at the surface. Then at a certain depth, we'll have P as a function of Z, where Z increases going down. So, hydrostatic pressure we've seen this behavior. Well, for hydrostatic pressure, the relationship is dP over dz equals gamma. But in this case, gamma is not constant. Gamma actually varies with z. So dP equals gamma dz, then I can integrate. The integral from P naught to PZ dP equals the integral from, so I'm just going to integrate both sides here, z naught to z of, and then I plug in my gamma equation, kz plus gamma naught dz. And I will get that p minus p naught equals, just doing the integral here with respect to z, kz, or k over 2, z squared, z naught is 0, plus gamma naught. Or, actually, gamma naught z here, gamma naught z. And this then comes to, with p naught being 0, I can get that p is equal to k over 2 z squared minus gamma naught z. And this would be in terms of gauge pressure. So this is how it will work for a gamma that is actually linearly increasing with depth. And again, this is gauge pressure. Gauge pressure. And that concludes the first portion of this lecture, and the others will be following shortly.